morning. So let me quickly recapture what we were discussing towards end of the last class, and then we'll continue our discussion. So the first step towards construction of the path table was that we started looking at something called a handle. And handle is a pattern which matches right-hand side of the production. And if I find such a pattern, and this pattern also gives me simultaneously a step in the reverse of right-most derivation, then I reduce it to the left-hand side. And then I continue, hoping that I reach the start symbol. And if the string is right, then I reach the start symbol. And if string is incorrect, then I reach another side. So notation-wise, if we are saying that start symbol in some steps of rightmost derivation gives me a sentential form alpha aw, where w is string of terminals, alpha is a string of terminals and non-terminals, and a is a non-terminal. And then one more rightmost derivation gives me a pattern which is alpha beta w, which means that there's a production which says a goes to beta, which is part of my grammar. Then if I find such a pattern and beta is a handle, then I can reduce beta to a, and this is what is giving me a step in the reverse of rightmost derivation. So a means that starting from w, I should keep on finding such handles and eventually attempt to reach the start symbol. So we only want to reduce handles and not any right hand side, and this is very important. That so the first example we discussed in the shift reduced parsing or in the bottom of parsing, where I was just matching a pattern without worrying about whether it was giving me a reversing rightmost step, that led to a situation where I could not move any, I could not go any further, and therefore came to a wrong conclusion that the string did not belong to the language. Actually, string was in the language. So handle pruning is, so this is the first thing we do, and this is really where we are moving towards the algorithm. And we are saying that handle pruning is a step where if I find a handle and I use this rule to reduce handle to its left hand side, then eventually parsing is nothing but it will take me to the start symbol, and rightmost derivation in reverse order can be obtained by just the handle. Right? So this is what we were discussing towards end of the previous class. So let's look at now some of the properties, because these are the kind of problems I am going to face in the parser, and therefore I should be aware of these. So one thing that happens is that there are two things which are happening in a shift reduced parser. There are only two possible actions. One is shift and reduce. Two other actions I will not worry about at this point of time, which is saying that I have reached an error state and therefore I must do an error recovery. And the fourth action is that I have reached this accept state, where I say that this pattern belongs to the language. Okay? So either I can shift something on the stack or I can do a reduction. Okay? And in cases where I have more than one choice, so suppose I have a situation where I can do both shift and I can do a reduce. Okay? And again, just to recall, if I write this grammar, then I was getting into a situation where I had both shift and reduce possibilities, and then we have to make a choice what to do, and that is known as shift reduce conflict. And normally I would like to design my grammars so that I do not get into a conflict like this. And similarly, I can get into a reduce-reduce conflict. So that what that means is that if I have a stack, and this is top of my stack, either I can find a beta 1, which matches some right-hand side, or I can find a beta 2. Okay? So this is, let me just draw it properly. So this may be beta 1, and this may be beta 2. And both match right-hand side of a production, and therefore I can get into a conflict saying which rule I should use for reduction. Okay? So normally, we would like to design our grammar so that I never encounter these kind of conflicts. So these conflicts are leading to a situation where I'm open to interpretation. So conflict can come because of two reasons. Either my grammar is not written properly, or the language is such that it does not fall into this class of languages for error. So that is what you want to attempt now. Oops, sorry. So let me give you an example of both shift reduce and reduce reduce conflicts. So here is the grammar we discussed, okay? And we have already seen this example that at this point of time, I was able to reduce, but also I was able to, I could have started slightly differently, okay, and I could have first shifted this and could have led to this reduction. So either I can reach start symbol by two different set of actions, and this is what the conflict is. Similarly, so this example we discussed extensively yesterday. Similarly, I may have a situation where I have a grammar like this. And this grammar is interesting because this grammar actually corresponds to the machine instructions. And what we are attempting here is at some point of time when we do code generation, we'll discuss it that even the machine instructions have grammar rules. So this is saying that a memory location can be computed by adding either two registers or a register plus a constant, or just a register can be loaded into memory location and a constant can be loaded into a register. Okay? And if I now try to do code generation for, or if I try to reduce this string, which is saying add two constants, this basically in terms of machine is saying that what are the kind of instruction sequence I want to generate. So I'll try to parse C plus C using the grammar like this. Okay? Now you can clearly see, even without going through parsing, that I can generate multiple instructions for this. So I can say load the first constant into a register, then add the register to a constant and store that in memory. Or I can say that load this constant into a register, load this constant into a register, add the two registers and then reduce it to memory. Okay? So these two patterns basically give me the conflict where I can get into a situation where I do shift reduce parsing. So I can here say that reduce by this rule, and then I have R plus R, and then I can say reduce by this rule, and here I have another possibility where I directly reduce by this rule. Okay? So I can get into multiple situations, but at this point of time, this example is not important. What is important is that I should be able to now design parsers and write grammars which are not going to be ambiguous. Okay? So this basically idea of just bringing these two examples first to say that there are some issues. And how do we resolve these issues is going to come when we start talking about parsing. Now here is the same structure or a similar structure to what we saw in a top-down parser. What I have is a stack, I have an input, then I have a parser, and then I have a parse table. Only difference is going to be that the structure of the parse table is going to be different, and then my parsing algorithm is going to be different. But basically I need to do certain manipulations. And the manipulations are going to be now looking at something which is at the top of stack and my input symbol or the lookahead symbol. Okay. Now, the first thing that comes here is that the way these parsers are designed, and that's why I said that in the beginning it does not appear to be as intuitive as a top-down parser. I have some concept of a state of the parser. So earlier my top of stack was only a symbol, which was a non-terminal symbol, or a terminal symbol, and depending upon that, and my input, I was able to take certain action. Now I say that my parser goes into certain states, and these are states which I can just give a unique number to each state. Doesn't matter what the number is, as long as this is unique. And I say that when I start pushing symbols on the stack, at the same time I push more information on the stack, which is saying that what is the state of the parser. Okay. We'll come to this point slightly later, what state means, what is it that is capturing. Okay. But at this point of time, just what we need to understand and remember is that there is something called a state of the parser. Okay. So what we are doing here is that my input is only going to contain of input strings. And what does my stack contain? So stack contains state symbols and grammar symbols. So all these S0, S1, up to Sn, these are the state symbols. And X1, X2, Xn, etc. are grammar symbols. So these grammar symbols could either be a terminal or a non-terminal. So to begin with, my parser is in certain state, and whenever a symbol is pushed on the stack, then the parser goes into a new state. So state symbol is always on the top of the stack. Okay? That's the only thing you need to remember. Okay? Basically, this also should give you a hint of what state symbol is capturing. Can you think of what is being captured by the state symbol? We'll not worry about how it captures it, but does this string give you some hint of what state symbol? What state symbol is capturing? No. So just strip out everything, and when I say my parser is in state X0, what does that mean? stack is empty, that is the initial state. Okay? And when I say some state S1, what that means is that what are the symbols below it? So basically, I define at some point of time what are the possible prefixes in my language, in my grammar, and then I say that corresponding to each of the prefix, I actually have a state symbol. Okay? So S1 says that if X1, if below S1, I have symbol X1 and the earlier state was S0, then this gives me actually something unique, which is known as state. So basically, if you recall now once again, I said that I'm going to introduce a special symbol dot, and somewhere I was saying that I'll have this alpha dot beta. Okay? This dot actually corresponds to the state, and this says that what is the prefix it has seen. Okay? And that is what I try to capture in each of the state symbols. Okay? But as we go along and I will start designing these states, then it will become more clear. But at this point of time, you can clearly see that if I know the state, some state number, then I can find out immediately just by looking at the state that what is the content of the stack. Okay? And my table contains now two parts. One is action part and one is go to part. Action part is indexed by the state numbers and all the terminal symbols. And go to part is indexed by the states and the non-terminal symbols. Okay? And we'll shortly see an example of this. And this is how we do parsing. So let's first look at an example and then go through this parser and how to construct this parse table. Okay? So here is a parser or a parse table for grammar like this. Okay? So this grammar is left recursive expression grammar. Okay? I'm not keeping minors and division and so on. Okay? So this says E goes to E plus T or T, T goes to T star F or F, and F goes to bracket expression and I. Okay? Now this is really the action table. This is the go-to table. These are my possible states. This grammar can have only 12 states from 0 to 12 because those are the prefixes which are possible in this grammar. And then I have these entries. And what do these entries mean? What these entries mean are that if I am in state 0 and I see ID, then I need to shift the symbol on the stack and go to state 5. So either I have these entries as S and some number, which is saying shift and go to the new state, or I will have entries like saying that reduced by rule number 4. So this says if I am in state 3 and I see plus S symbol, that means I have identified a handle and reduced by rule number 4. And rule number 4 is this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. These are the 6 rules I have. So you can see that all my entries in the parse table are either empty, which means that it is error, or it is either a shift action or a reduce action, except one place where it says that I have reached an accept state, which means that this is now a valid state. Okay? And what does this table tell me? This says that if I am in state 0 and on top of state 0, the non-terminal is E, then I must go to state 1. Okay? Or if I am in state 4 and the non-terminal on top of state 4 is T, then my parser should be in state 2 and so on. So we don't know how to construct this table. We don't even know how to use this table, but that is the interpretation of this table. Okay. Now, first thing I want to do is, without really worrying about how this table has been constructed, I would like to take an example and take you through the steps of shift-reduce parsing, just keeping this table in mind. So suppose I am trying to parse ID star ID plus ID. Okay? And as dollar indicates, that's the special symbol I have put at the end of my input. So this is what my input is. And what is my stack? Stack to begin with is always in state 0. Okay? That is where my initial configuration starts with. Okay? And what I need to now check is, by going through these actions of this table, will I ever reach a situation where my state of the parser is 1 and the lookahead symbol is dollar? Okay? If I reach that particular state, then I know that I will be in accept state, which is a valid state. Okay, so is intent clear what we are trying to do here? So let's look at this table. Okay. Now also this table should tell you something like what we are looking in the top-down parser. If I am in state 0, which is initial state, okay, then all valid strings can start either with an identifier or with a left parenthesis. Anything else gives me an error. Okay. So if I attempt to start a string by a plus or a multiplication or a right parenthesis, that's an error. Okay. And I'll not worry about empty strings, so I'll not even say that in state 0, if I see an empty string, then I should reach accept string. I mean, that's trivial because all null strings will belong to all graphs. Okay. So if I am in state 0 and I see ID, then what do I do? I shift the symbol on the stack and I go to a new state, which is 5. So my stack becomes 0ID5. Okay. So you can see that initially I was in some state, and after this shifting the symbol, I have reached a new state. And what is my input now? My input is ID plus ID dollar. Okay. And now I see that in state 5, if I see star, in state 5, if I see star, this says reduced by rule number 6. My rule number 6 is F goes to ID. Okay. Now when I say that I am reducing this symbol, okay, essentially what that means is that both these symbols will have to be popped from the stack. Okay. So after I pop these symbols, and how many symbols do I pop now? So how did I arrive at this number 1, 2, 3 or whatever? So I need to pop twice the length of the right-hand side. The number of symbols which have to be popped is twice the length of the right-hand side. And why? Because between every two grammar symbols, there is going to be a state symbol. So for every grammar symbol, if the length of the right-hand side is n, n grammar symbols, I need to pop those n symbols, and therefore I will also need to pop another n state symbols. Okay? So if the length of the right-hand side is 1, I just pop 2 symbols from the stack, and I go into configuration like this. Okay? And then what do I push on the stack? The left-hand side of the rule. Okay? So I push left-hand side of the rule on the stack, and now I must determine what is the new state of my parser. And how do I find out new state of my parser? By looking at go to table, which says if top of stack symbol is this non-terminal and the state symbol just below this is 0, then refer to 0f, which says that now parser must be in state 3. Have you understood how I arrived from 0id5 to 0f3? Is this clear to everyone? Yes? No? Yes? Okay. So now, how do I continue? Okay. Now I say, let me refer to 3 star, because input has not changed. And when I refer to 3 star, this says reduced by rule number 4. Okay. So what will be my stack configuration? Somebody will tell me the stack configuration now. Mm-hmm. When I reduce rule number, reduced by rule number 4. Rule number 4 says T goes to F. 0. 0. And? 0t, and what will be the state? 2. Okay. So my parser will go into this state. Okay. Nothing changes in there. Right? You have understood what has happened? So I pop 2 symbols, I push left hand side, then I refer to go to table corresponding to 0t and go into a new state. Okay. Now I look at 2 star. What is 2 star? 2 star says shift and go to state 7. Okay. So I now say that I will shift this symbol and I will go to state 7. And what will be my input? My input will be ID plus ID top. So what I have done is I have shifted this symbol on the stack, and because this NP set I was in 2 star, right? So 2 star was taking me to state 7. Okay. Now I look at 7ID, and what does 7ID say? Shift and go to state 5. Okay. So now I'll say 0T2 star 7ID5, and my input becomes this. Okay. What is the next thing? Now I say I'm in state 5 and I see plus. So if I'm in state 5 and I see plus, what does it mean? Reduced by rule number 6, which says f goes to id. So I'm going to pop two symbols from the stack. Okay, so I'm going to pop these two symbols, and this is going to give me a configuration like this. And then I'm going to push left-hand side on the stack, which is f. And then what will be the new state of my parser? 7f. And 7f is 10. And now if I say, what is 10 plus? So I look at 10 plus, and 10 plus says reduced by rule number 3. And what is rule number 3? Rule number 3 says t goes to t star f. So how many symbols do I pop?
Six.
Six symbols, because length of the right-hand side is 3. So I'm going to pop all these 6 symbols from the stack, and I'm going to first remain with 0, and then what will I push on the left-hand side? What will I push on the stack? The left-hand side, which is t. And what will be my state now?
2.
Right? So 0, t is 2. So I go into this state. And then I look at 2 plus, and 2 plus says reduced by rule number 2. And what is rule number 2? E goes to t. So that means I'll go into state E0E1. Okay? And now in 1, if I see plus, this says shift and go to state 6. So I'm going to now 0E1. ID 6. Sorry. This should be plus. Okay. And now if I, so and my input is now ID tall. Okay. And now if I see, so let me continue on this part. Okay. And now if I see 6 ID, what is 6 ID? 6 ID says shift and go to state 5. So that will take me to 0E1 plus 6 ID 5, and my input will be $5. Okay. And now if I look at $5 says reduced by rule number 6, and 6 is F goes to ID. So that takes me to the state. This, and what is 6F? 6F is 3, so my parser goes into state 3. And now I look at $3, and $3 says reduced by rule number 4, and rule number 4 is t goes to f. So my parser now becomes 0e1 plus 6t. And what is 6t? 6t is taking me to state 9. Okay. And now I look at $9, and $9 says reduced by rule number 1. And rule number 1 is e goes to e plus t. So I'm going to pop 6 symbols from the stack. So I pop 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, and then I push left hand side on the stack, and then I go into state 1. And now I look at $1, and what is $1? Accept. So I reach the final state, saying that there's a valid string in the sign. So you understand how this parse table is being interpreted now, right? Okay. So let's now, so we still don't know how to take this grammar and encode it into a parse table like this. But what we definitely know now is that given a parse table and given an input, how do I go through the process of parsing? Okay. So let me just take you through the same thing. You have already seen this. Okay. So we'll skip this part. Okay. So what are the actions? What are the things I'm doing? Okay. So actions were that I was looking at the top of the state symbol, which was the state symbol of my parser, and I'm looking at the input symbol. And based on these two combinations, I was taking actions which said, possibly I can shift, I can reduce, I can accept, or I can go into an error state. These are the only four possibilities I had. And what were the possibilities in terms of, if I use these symbols, if I say my stack is in certain configuration like this, where top of stack is some state m and my input is this, then action will say that, so I'm looking at this state symbol and I'm looking at AI, and I refer to the action table, and if I look at action table, an entry is corresponding to shift and go to a new state. What that means is that after this configuration is going to be that I'm going to push AI on top of stack. I'll go to new state S, and my input will now have one less symbol. Instead of AI, the first symbol will be AI plus one. Okay? Or if it is a reduced action, which is corresponding to some rule, then what will I do? I'll find out length of beta. I'll pop twice this number of symbols of beta. So what happens here, if length of beta is R, then I'm going to pop 2R symbols from this, and after popping 2R symbols, I'll be left with top of stack as XM minus R and SM minus R. Then I push left hand side, and then I'm going to go to a new state, which will be corresponding to go to of SM minus R and A. Right? This is what we did. Okay? And then I can either be in the accept state. So if this is accept, then what do? I just thought, saying that I have a valid string. And if this is error state, then we'll have to do some invocation of error recovery. But we'll not talk about error recovery at this point in time. Okay? That we'll talk about later. So is parsing action clear to everyone? Okay? So if I go back once again to my parser, let me take you back to the same figure. Okay? We at least understand how do I manipulate stack, how do I manipulate input, and what does my parser do. Okay? What I have not understood so far is that how do I construct action table and go to paper. Okay? With respect to this figure, this is the only box now which is left unexplained. Everyone is in sync. Everyone understands how the parser is working. Okay, so let's then move on. So algorithmically, the same thing. If I try to write as a block, my initial state is S0 or 0, and my input is W dollar. And if action is shift, then I push A on the stack, I push S prime on the stack, I increment input pointer by 1. If action is reduced by this rule, then I pop twice the length of beta symbols from the stack, push A, and then push go to of S double prime A, and where S double prime is the state exposed after popping all these symbols. Okay? And if this is accept, then I exit. Otherwise, I go into error. So you can see that actually parsing algorithm is fairly simple, straightforward. Okay? So once again, okay, let's come to this table and try to see how do I construct this table. Okay? Now, to construct this table, I need to have few more definitions and some more information. Okay? So first information that is going to come is that what do these state symbols mean? Okay? These state symbols, as I said, what they mean is that what is on the stack. Okay? So it is actually looking at what is on the stack, and it cannot be an infinitely long string. Okay? Because all the time, I'll keep on doing reduction. What is the maximum length of the stack you can have in the worst case? In the worst case, what could be the maximum height of the stack? Number of? Twice the number of tokens, plus one. Right? So if my length of the input is n, then it is possible that first I'll do all shift before I do the first reduction. So corresponding to n symbols I am going to push on the stack, I will have to push state n state symbols, and the initial state symbol will be there. So that is the maximum size up I can have of the stack. It cannot be larger than that. So every state symbol, what it is capturing is that what is on the stack. What is my, what we know as viable prefix. So parser state is, goal is to know what are the valid deductions at any given point of time. Okay? So I can do it, I can keep on shifting. But at some point of time, I'll have to do reduction, and I need to know what is the reduction rule I need to use, and state summarizes all possible stack prefixes in any parser state. Okay? So for example, when I say my parser is in state 0, okay, what that means is that my parser stack does not have anything. That's empty. Okay? And similarly, each state will capture something more. Okay? So this is, parser state is actually defined by, again, a finite state machine, okay, and which reads stack, okay, and this finite state machine right now may not be clear. In fact, you may be wondering why we are talking of finite state machine, because we are doing parsing now. Okay? We should have been talking about pushdown automata and so on. Okay? But you will see something very interesting, that The way I am going to term all these states, that will actually construct a finite state machine. Okay? So except state are infinite state machines are nothing but unique reductions. Okay? That somewhere I'll be able to uniquely find which is the right reduction rule to use. So for example here, okay, I was able to say I want to reduce by rule. When I was in this state, here I was shifting. Where else I was doing reduction? So for example in 10, I was doing a reduction and so on. Okay? So there are some states in which I was able to find absolute reductions, and these reductions were finally telling me that I can eventually reach a start state. Okay? So let's start slowly constructing the power state. Okay? And whatever definitions we need to know for that, okay, we'll introduce. So first step I do is I modify the grammar itself. Okay? And what I do is I say that I want to augment my grammar. Okay? And what does augmentation of grammar mean? Augmentation of grammar means is that if I started with some context-free grammar, and this context-free grammar consists of a set of non-terminals, terminals, some start symbol, and a set of productions. Okay? Then I'm going to modify this. And what is the modification? So let me call this augmented grammar as G prime. And now I'm going to say that I'll have one more non-terminal, which I'm going to call as prime. I'm going to not change the set of my terminals. I'll change my start symbol to S prime. And I'll change my productions to say that whatever productions I have, and I have one more production as this. So what I've introduced is a new non-terminal, which I'm going to call the new start symbol, and I have introduced one more rule which says that S prime goes to S. Now does it in any way changes the string of set of strings I'm going to accept? Does not, right? Then why I'm doing this manipulation?
But S prime will not be in line side of
Well, that's not really the real reason that S prime should not be in the right hand side of any production. I mean, what you're saying is a correct observation that S prime will never be on the right hand side of any production, but that's not the reason I'm changing it. The reason I'm changing it is I'm now saying that only when I do a reduction by this particular rule, then I'll use the accept state. Okay? In earlier cases, when I have something like this, so for example, when I said E goes to E plus T or E goes to T, I could reach accept state either by reducing this or by reducing this. Okay? So there could have been multiple entries. They could have been multiple states which will take me to accept state. This is a unique situation where I say that only by reducing this state, I reach an accept state. Okay? So there is only a small cosmetic change. Does not change anything in the language I am dealing with. So if G is a grammar with start symbol S, then augmented grammar G prime has a new start symbol S prime and a new rule S prime to S, and when parser reduces by this rule, it will stop with accept. Nowhere else I'll do an accept. So this is the first change I make. Now I define viable prefixes. Okay? Now the reason I want to go into this definition of viable prefixes, because at some point of time I want to capture all this information about states. Okay? So now this is saying that suppose I am doing these reductions. State has certain symbols, and stack has certain symbols, and it has certain grammar and the state symbols. So prefix is viable prefix is that if I take all possible sequential forms in my language, okay, then what could be the stack configuration? I want to find out all possible stack configurations. Okay? Because those are the, in my valid sequential forms, those are the only valid parsing states I can have. Everything else is incorrect. Okay? So this is what I want to define, that what are the valid prefixes in any configuration of shift-reduced parser. And we say that alpha is a viable prefix of the grammar, and it depends on not on the language but on the form of the grammar. Because different grammars will give me different state stack configurations. Okay? So what we are saying here is that alpha is some symbol. Alpha is actually a string of terminals and non-terminals, and this is a viable prefix in the grammar. If we have some such W, okay, such that alpha W is in right sentential form, that means if I do a rightmost derivation, then I'll get some string or some string somewhere where alpha W will be the valid sentential form of my graph. Okay? And also that alpha W is a valid configuration of my shift-reduced parser. That means if I do reverse of rightmost derivation, then sometime I'll be able to see alpha on the stack and W as the input. then only I say that this is a viable business. Okay? So you can see now what I am doing. Okay? If I look at this stack, okay? If you see stack configuration, you can see that when I reached state 3, okay? What was my prefix? My prefix was that my parser initially was in state 0 and the only symbol which could be on the stack was 3. Okay? Or here, only symbol my parser could have was T or my parser could have T star. So if I, for the time being, if I ignore all state symbols, or here I could say my parser could have T star ID, I could have T star F. Okay? I cannot have something arbitrary like T star E. Okay? That will never be my parser configuration. Okay? So what I'll start counting by looking at the grammar is, or what I'll start constructing by looking at the grammar are all possible configurations of my stack, okay, which I call as viable prefix. Okay? Because this viable prefix is the one which captures all my state information. Okay? So as long as parser has only viable prefixes in the stack, then I know that parser has not seen an error. Okay? Parser is always in a valid state. But if I try to go into a stack configuration which is not correct, then immediately I say that I will not be able to do a shift and reduce, because this leads to a situation where my parser is does not contain a viable prefix. Okay. So set of viable prefixes is a regular language. Now this is not an obvious proof. Okay. And this is what actually, when you say set of viable prefixes is a regular language, that is where we are actually using a DFA. Okay. So what we are computing are, first, starting with a context-free grammar, I compute all sets of viable prefixes, and then I say, since this is actually a regular language, I can implement it by a finite state machine. So who devised bottom-up parsers, LR parsers? Any idea? Who gave the LR parsing algorithm? Was a compiler writer or language designer who gave LR parsing? It's not a multiple choice question. I'm not giving you four choices and pick out one by elimination. No idea? Better known for his work in algorithms, okay? But this is something he did it way back in 1963-1964. Okay? In fact, his fourth volume of Art of Programming is supposed to be writing 7 volumes. Only 3 were published, and the fourth one which Orton is working on is actually is on parsing. Okay? So this is the proof which is given in his original paper, that if I take any kind of context-free grammar and I try to find viable prefixes for this. In fact, I mean, truth method of parsing was so difficult that it was not even implemented for a long time till somebody gave a much better method called D-Reamer. He gave a method for constructing what we now know as simple error parsers. So we'll go through all simple error parsers and then we'll look at the most complex ones. Okay? But what we are talking about is this important proof that somebody could visualize that if I construct all viable prefixes, that actually gives me a regular language. So what we do is, once we have constructed all viable prefixes, we just need to construct a finite state machine program. Yeah. And that is what my, if you now recall the parse table, what is my parse table? That's just a finite state machine, right? It's not doing anything else. Okay. So first, now, let's start constructing it. Okay. So first thing I do is, I say that, and this is my attempt to construct all the viable prefixes, I say that I define something known as an LR0i. So now if I look at any rule, if I look at a grammar, so suppose this is my grammar. Okay? And let me just pick up one of the rules of the grammar. Okay? Now I say that I can put dot anywhere on the right hand side. Okay? So suppose I put dot anywhere on the right hand side. Obviously it has to be between two symbols, so I can get something like this. Either I can have a dot in the first position, or I can have a dot in the second position, or I can have a dot in this position, or I can have a dot in this position. Okay. And what is this dot? Dot is the special marker we had, which says what is on the stack and what is in the input. Okay. So this says that if I want to do reduction by this rule, okay, so conceptually what is happening now is, I am saying that I am trying to now compute all viable prefixes. So this is, for this, what is the viable prefix? Null. And for this configuration, what is the viable prefix? E. And for this, this is E plus, and for this is E plus T. From this grammar rule, I cannot have any other viable prefix. These are the only combinations I can have. Right? And similarly, I need to do it for all the grammar rules I have. So if I have this rule which says E goes to T, then what are the LR0 items for this? So this I call as set of LR0 items. Okay? So set of LR0 items are that if I take, now this is not a production, but this is an LR0 item. Okay? So an LR0 item is that if I take a grammar rule and I put a dot anywhere on the right hand side, it becomes an LR0 item. Okay? And this is giving me some unique combinations. So what are the LR0 items I can have from this? I can have either this or I can have this. There's nothing else I can do. Okay. And what I need to do now is, for all grammar symbols, constructs all possible LR0 items. So that is giving me all sets of possible viable prefixes. Okay. This is saying that I can, if I want to do this reduction conceptually, then this is saying that I have not seen anything, but I must see a derivation of E plus T if I want to reduce this to an E, and E plus T is a handle. This says, if I have already seen E, then I am expecting to see a derivation of plus T. And this says, if I have already seen E plus, then I am expecting to see a derivation of T. And this says, if I have seen E plus T, then doesn't matter what comes in, okay, I am ready to reduce this to the left hand side. So what I said in the end is not entirely correct, but I don't want to introduce at this point of time. Okay? So what are the situations under which I can do reduction by this rule to E? So what should be, so here says that suppose I am in this configuration, okay? I have seen E, then what I am expecting to see is a plus, right? And if I am in this configuration where I have seen E plus, then I am seeing that I should be able to see something which is derivable from T. That means obviously the first symbols of T. And if I have seen E plus T, I am ready to reduction on E. Under what circumstances? So look at my parser. What will happen in my parser state? I will have E plus T, and this is my input. And I will say that I am ready to reduce this to E. Okay. Now, what are the situations under which this reduction can remain valid, that this plus this will be a valid sentential form in my language? Is there a property I can attribute to this symbol? Can it be any symbol? Can it be any arbitrary symbol in my grammar? Come on guys, this is not a difficult question, I mean, which you are not able to even visualize. Can I put, say, ID here? No. Why? So I must have a symbol which is in follow of E. Because if I don't have a symbol which is in follow of E, okay, then I have a problem obviously, because I'll not be able to reduce any further. So whenever you are ready for reduction by this, you say that if I have reached a configuration where dot is in the rightmost position and I have seen the whole of the right hand side of a production, I can reduce it only if my look ahead symbol is in follow of the left hand side. Okay? Otherwise it will give me a wrong sentential form. I will not be able to proceed from that. Okay? So what we need to do therefore is, I need to construct LR0 items and then all possible sets of all LR0 items. Okay? So an LR0 item is, in a grammar, is a production in which dot is in some position on the right hand side, okay? And if I have a production of this form which says A goes to XYZ, then what are the LR0 items I can get? I can get these possible LR0 items, that dot can be on the leftmost position after X, after Y, or after Z. Okay? These are the only LR0 items I can get. And conceptually this says that how much of production has been seen at a point and what is it that I am expecting to see. Symbols of the left hand dot are already on the stack, and what I am expecting is that remaining symbols on the right hand side must be in the input. or not right hand side in the input, but derivation of the right hand side in the input. Yeah, because if I say that my right hand side is in T, obviously T will never be in input. Input consists only of my terminal symbols. Okay? So if I see a derivation of T, then first I will push those on the stack, reduce them to T, and then only do the shift. Okay? Now, to find out all these possible sets of LR0 items, one operation I need to introduce is what we know as closure operation. Okay? Now, what is closure operation? Closure operation is saying, and we'll keep this part here, okay, that somewhere, if I say that I have seen something in my input and I am ready to see something more. Suppose I reach a configuration which is of this form. A goes to, let's say, alpha dot B beta. Okay? Suppose this is my configuration at some point of time. Okay? This is my LR0 item. What this means is that I have seen alpha and I am expecting to see a derivation of B beta. And B happens to be a non-terminal. Then what I will do is, I will say that I am going to define a closure set of this, and I say that conceptually, if I am expecting to see a derivation of B beta, then I must see first derivations of beta, derivations corresponding to B, right? That is a non-terminal. Okay? So if now B has some rule of this form, okay, which says B goes to, let's say, PQR, something like this. Okay? Then I must add an item which says B goes to dot PQR. So this is my rule, this is my LR0 item. Okay? And this LR0 item must be added into the closure set. So what is closure trying to do? Closure is saying that if I have an LR0 item like this and I want to find its closure, this LR0 item says that I have seen alpha and I am expecting to see a derivation of B beta. But since B is a non-terminal, there must be some rules corresponding to B. And if this is the rule corresponding to B, then I am expecting to see a derivation of starting with dot PQR. Yes, no? Is it making sense or no? So for example here, if I say that I am expecting to see a derivation of T. Okay? Then what are the rules corresponding to T? Rules corresponding to T are T goes to T star F or T goes to F. Which means that if I am expecting to see a derivation of T, then first I must see either this derivation, which eventually I can reduce to T, or I must see this derivation, which eventually I can reduce to T. So closure operation is saying that starting from an LR0 item, if I want to find its closure, then add that particular LR0 item into the set, and if there is a non-terminal immediately on the right of dot, take all its productions, put dot in the leftmost position, and those are the LR0 items I am expecting to see in that particular state. Okay? So let's stop here today, and tomorrow we will start our discussion from this point onwards, and remember that tomorrow we have an extra class starting at 11:45.